to be using the off-car brake lathe to cut a brake rotor. The brake rotor that we're going to be using is for a 2008 Dodge Ram 1500. It's the rear rotor. It is a rear-vented rotor that is one piece. Our first step is we're going to have to measure to make sure that it's within the minimum thickness. The minimum thickness per the factory service information is 803 thousandths. If we use a micrometer and make sure that we get around the heavy ridge that can be built up on the edge, we're going to measure and see if we're within tolerances. Right now, I know it's probably difficult to see on camera, but we're 868 thousandths, which we have a little bit of room to machine through. As long as we leave about 10 to 20 thousandths before minimum, it should be acceptable to drive about 30,000 miles with fresh set of brake pads. So now that we know we're in our minimum specifications, the next thing is to mount the rotor onto the brake lathe itself. There's a variety of different ways to do it. You first have to start with a centering hub. So you're going to get a hub that's going to fit in this back area of this rotor. Because this rotor is also used for the parking brake and as an internal drum, it's rather large. So we're going to try to use the biggest centering hub that we can and make sure that it fits in the middle. That's the first component that gets put onto the brake lathe. After that, you then use a spring. The spring is used to center the cone that goes inside of the hub of the rotor itself. Now, I don't have a particular cone that will fit, but this is an example to where it would go into the rotor, either the front or the back. But what we are going to use is I'm going to use a chuck system to be able to chuck the rotor up and center it. So the key with these, though, is to make sure that you get it tight and you double check that it stays tight and it stays centered. These do have a tendency to come loose, which can create an issue if the rotor is spinning too fast. So we want to make sure we're nice and tight there and we're centered on the hub. We can mount the rotor now onto the lathe. From here, we have to take up this space before we get to the threads. So the brake lathe comes with a variety of different spacers. We're going to use a stack of spacers to be able to achieve the correct amount of take up on the shaft. Now, the nut that mounts this rotor up is going to be left-hand thread, so it's going to be lefty-tighty, righty-loosey. So make sure that you're doing that, because it does make it a bit interesting, and they can be cross-threaded. The next is we're going to take our double crescent wrench, that is the wrench that's for the brake lathe, and just give it a little bit of a tap to tighten it up. At this point, what I like to do is I like to retract the head and then make sure the speed is a good speed. What we're also looking for, too, is I like to try to make sure that the rotor is turning nice and straight. This brake lathe is up against a brick wall that you can't really see in shot. What I like to do is I like to try to mount the brake lathe so that I can line up with one of the grout lines against the brick and make sure that I can see that the rotor is turning nice and smooth. Our rotor is, so what we can do is we can shut this off and we're going to do a couple anti-chatter devices to be able to prevent a irregular pattern from being worn into the rotor. Our first one is going to be our springs that will go around the vents. These simply just snap around the outside of the rotor. Now you only use these if you have a vented rotor. If you have a solid rotor, you're not going to use this, and you can use a rubber band with weights on it is the other option. We're also going to be using the anti-chatter little brake pads here that are going to go on the cutting head, which we'll set up when we actually cut the brake rotor itself. At this point now, we need to determine the speed that the motor is going to be turned at. This Hunter brake lathe has the ability to be able to change the speed in three different ratios. What we go off of is we go off of how big of our rotor is. So our overall diameter dictates what the spindle speed is going to be. Our rotor lands in between 8 and 14 inches, so we're going to be at 110 RPM from the motor, so we're going to line right in the middle of the speeds. To adjust that speed, you actually flip the top up right here, and you just change the belt from one pulley to another. So that's already set. The next thing that I have to set is I have to center the cutting head. So we're going to use our brake wrench jam nut, and then we're able to move the cutting head. You want to make sure that the cutting head is going to be centered on the rotor, and that both cutting die are as centered as possible. So once we're satisfied with where that needs to be, we need to lock that down and make sure that it's not going to come loose on us. At this point, we're ready to see if we can get a test hit on the rotor. So I turn the motor speed on, and I roll the cutting disc to where they're right about the middle of the rotor. The reason why you want to do right about the middle of the rotor is because if there's any warp or distortion in the rotor, this will hopefully find the low spot. So what we're going to do is we're going to get the cutting teeth or the cutting blades at the contact point of the rotor. So what you're going to do is you're going to turn the dial right here until you hear it contact. So you'll hear it kind of a high-pitched noise once it contacts. So right there, I turned the locking tab just a little bit because we're going to go in and take the rust burr off on the inside, and that will prevent it from backing out. We're going to do the same thing on the inside portion. So now we're going to use our handle and roll this all the way in. And we're going to get to that inner rust lip. Cut that inner rust lip off. We do that on both the front and the back. So now you can hear that it's gone quiet. We've gone into this intersection of the hub that there is no pad contacting surface. So then what we're going to do is we're going to dial in how much we want to cut off of each side. Now this is in ten thousandths of an inch increments. What I like to do is I like to do two notches on each dial. So loosening the locking tab, going off the centering line, I'm going to go to the right, two notches, and then lock that down. You don't have to go too tight with these, you just got to hit it just a little bit. Same thing with the other side. So now we're locked into how much we're actually going to cut off the rotor. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to mount our anti-chatter pad. Now the chatter pad has this Velcro strap that's supposed to be able to keep it on the head. I found that they don't always work very well. So what I like to do is I like to take the wrench and put the wrench right on top of that so that now our anti-chatter pads won't fling off. So our next step we need to do is we need to dial in the speed of how much the cutting head is going to retract. If we're going to do multiple passes, if we know the rotor's warped or if it has issues, you can do a little bit faster pass on the pole. If you're going to do a one-cut pass where you're planning on having it have a consistent finish, you want it to pull out to retract as slow as possible. So we're going to put it at a medium speed, and then we're going to engage. You can't really see the clutch mechanism. If I were to pull it closer towards me, that would indicate for it to be a drum actuation, but we're going to push it towards the machine. That's going to be activating as a disc. So now we're going to have the rotor cut, making sure we're paying attention to the cutting heads and listen to hear if there's any issues. You want to hear the cutting heads make a nice consistent cut on both sides. If you start to hear it feather or it kind of flutter a little bit, that's an indication that there's a warp in the rotor and potentially you're going to have to make another cut. We will have to determine then at that point whether or not the rotor is discardable or not. At this point, we're getting to the edge of the rotor where the pad doesn't always contact. So our anti-chatter pads, we need to make sure don't fly off. We're also, too, you're going to hear a change in how the cutter is actually cutting against it because we're cutting thicker materials. Now we're going to disengage the clutch, turn off our motor speed. This is where you're going to inspect the cut of the rotor. So what we're looking for is we're looking for kind of a dull finish with no grooves in it. What can happen is if the rotor begins to chatter, you can get a consistent line that gets grooved in it and looks quite, you know, a lot like a record. That will cause brake squeak on application, so we're trying to avoid that. For the brake pads to run quietly, they need an irregular pattern. So that's why cutting it slowly creates an irregular pattern against the brake rotor face, and we don't have that issue. At this point, what you do is we're going to back the cutting head off a little bit. I always like to snap the spring off now because they do tend to come off a bit violently. Again, remember when we're loosening this, it's lefty tighty, righty loosey because it is a left hand thread bolt. Break that loose. Pull off our shims. Then we can pull the rotor off. Now, typically with a standard brake job, you'd be doing two rotors. So we've already got the machine set up to be able to do a second rotor. You'd then install this on the vehicle, do your second rotor, and have it ready to go. One of the things to note before, make sure we get the chuck off. I stated these things can stick a little bit. There we go. One of the things that we need to make sure we do is we need to make sure when we get the rotor mounted onto the vehicle that we clean off all of the brake shavings and dust. It's usually best to do that once you have it mounted onto the vehicle, because as you just saw where I just touched right there, any oils or imperfections that are in your hands or in your gloves will get onto the rotor and can impregnate into the pad material and cause the brakes to warp or not apply as well. So cleaning it right before you put the caliper on and the pads on is usually the best bet to where you're not going to get any imperfections in the rotor surface. So our last step is we're going to make sure that we're not within minimum spec because we've cut a little bit of material off of it. So again, our minimum specification for this rotor is 803 thousandths. So we'll measure it again. So our before measurement was 868 thousandths. Right now we are at 858. So we lost about 10 thousandths off of it, but we're still well within specification to where we don't have to discard this rotor. So this rotor is good to go back on the vehicle, and it will at least serve another 30,000 miles, if not more, with the brake pads. Thank you for watching. In the next video, we'll cover cutting drums.